Thomas from Camelot, and you're listening to La Grosse Radio. Probably not. I mean, every record is exhausting to a certain extent because we always push the time. You know, maybe a record label's like, we need to have the master, you know, and we're like, well, we're not done yet. And then we keep pushing the time, and because we want to pack every little thing into every record that we can. And we've never been a band that, like, does a song quickly and goes, okay, it's done. We always go back, listen to it. What can we do better here? What can we make better? And the same thing goes with the artwork, you know? Like, we agonize over little, small details in the cover. You know, like, I can tell you there's stuff in here that you probably don't notice at first that is in there that I personally went, okay, well, you need to do this and do that. I want this black rose to be here. And it's just one of those the methods that we kind of do every time, and it's a labor of love. And at the end of the day, we can always say that we put our heart and soul into it. You know? There are references in the record throughout to certain items, things. I can say, like, for one of them, like, is this rose of obsidian. It's black rose that you'll hear mentioned here and there in the album. Mm-hmm. And it's not a concept record, but there is a theme. There is some sort of story there that we felt started to evolve as we were working on the songs and the lyrical ideas. And the idea for the cover was this. It's basically like a two-part thing where this beautiful girl inside, you know, she doesn't have that on the outside.
Yeah.
And then you have the dark kind of feel, which it's a skull in the back, you know.
Yeah.
So there's like three kind of elements to her character or to her person, you know. Inside she feels beautiful, and outside she's not, you know. Mm-hmm. And then you always have this sort of evil back skull in the back of your head that's... It crops up here and there, but and the title Haven, for me, I wanted a record that hopefully, even if it's one or two fans, they can get lost in the album and escape from maybe the stress of their normal life or whatever it may be. And there was always these albums for me when I was a kid that also did that. My dear, I promise death comes to all in the heart. What I can remember coming from school, I had to move to this town that was like bleak, awful, like crappy apartment. And I think I got the Ozzy album and one of the Scorpions records. And I would just listen to those albums over and over. And actually at the time I was always thinking about having a band. I would draw logos, you know, and have a marker and... Yeah, so that was kind of a period, a haven for me to kind of not go out and rob somebody or whatever, you know. I mean, it definitely kept me from going on the wrong path. We always, for some reason, have a woman on the cover. I don't know if that's because we always have stories that kind of relate to, I mean, obviously the stories relate to everybody, but we have these stories, these tragic kind of tales that usually, whether it's a man or a woman, there's always a woman involved with it somehow, you know, and I think that a man can relate to that, and of course a woman. We talked about maybe not having a woman on this cover, but when we started thinking about this, the Veil of Elysium and this thing with vanity and stuff like that, it just made more sense to have that character. You know? Now winter has come and I stand in the snow. I don't feel the cold. It's all that I will ever need. Yeah, the idea basically is to show and discuss these darker, maybe disturbing things in life, but also to show some kind of hope. Mm-hmm. Maybe in the end, humanity wins, you know. Technology, at some point, you know, it gets pushed aside, hopefully. So we want the record to have that contrast of dark and light. And at the end of the record, you know, hopefully you feel like there is this still this hope that things can get better, you know. And I always want our albums to have some sort of inspiration, you know, whether, you know, whoever can help is awesome. And I don't want it to be a downer, you know. We kind of had a record like that, but
yeah.
I want this one to have those contrasts. I think it has to lie within the choruses, you know. You want the choruses to have some sort of uplifting, memorable feel. Mm-hmm. And lyrically, you want them to have something that people can relate to and that touches you, you know. Like, well, on Under Gray Skies, it's a song about this guy that, you know, he basically always trusts somebody or something. And he says, you know, I'll always believe in you, even though people disappoint us all the time, right? But this character continues to say, I'll always believe in you, which is kind of a cool thing. And then, you know, hopefully at the end of the day, that person that sort of disappoints you comes through. Yeah, I mean, we have a great time. Everybody on stage wants to be there. I can't remember last time anybody's ever argued. And Tommy's just become this monster frontman that is just super cool, inspiring. You know, I think being, you know, more integral into the songwriting gives him more confidence as well. So it's great. I mean, we toured like hell on Silverthorne, and we're going to be doing probably even more on Haven. So I think that's a testament to the choices that we've made with our, you know, going with our gut to go with him as a new singer, and also the chemistry that we have now. Now pull down your fortress and swallow your pride. Some of it, yeah. I mean, there's a lot of work to do with just lyrics and vocals, you know. Mm-hmm. So there were some parts and some songs. He worked with Sasha on some ideas and stuff. And then last year I got him a ESP guitar. So he's been working on his guitar riffs. So I got a couple of those for the next album now, which is actually pretty cool. So that's going to be fun. No. Oliver is a shredder. If we did that, we would just have him kind of do, like, you know, mm-hmm. play some guitar, play keyboards. Mm-hmm. But ironically, we played 2 days ago in London, and we have a song called Hunter Season that has Gus G on it playing a solo. Mm-hmm. And Gus G's band was the support band for us at the show, so we had him come up and play Hunter Season. And it's pretty cool having another guitar player on stage, but it's a little crowded. But yeah. It was awesome because Gus has been a friend for years, and just amazing guitar player. Part of the family now, you know. And so whenever she can tour with us, she's going to try to make that happen. Arch Enemy has been super cool about that. Mm-hmm. And yeah, when we started thinking about the new album, and I thought about Alyssa, I wanted to have her, but I didn't want her to just do the growly stuff, you know, uh-huh. because she's done that and people know how that is, but not a lot of fans, at least Camelot fans, have heard her sing clean. She although she does it on our live shows. So I wanted to have that on the album as well, and she killed it on Liar Liars. It was awesome, and that's going to be, I think, a really cool, might be one video we do maybe in the future, is Liar Liar. Well, I think Charlotte is probably one of the most unique vocals in the whole female fronted thing. You know, you can immediately hear her over the more of the opera type bands. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
It's a signature sound, and I thought that she'd be perfect for Under Gray Skies. That, and it sounds awesome. And then we had Troy from Nightwish play some of his signature kind of pipes, you know, on that. And he's been a friend since we toured with Nightwish in North America. And super cool guy, really, you know, awesome to hang out with. He's also an amazing magician, believe it or not. You would be just floored by how he does some stuff I can't figure out, put it that way. Super nice guy, and so to have him on the record it's been awesome. It's very difficult for me to work on tour.
Oh yeah.
We put everything into the show, and then the day is full with either VIP meet and greets or stuff like that. So it's really hard for me to focus on, you know, on writing. So when I get home from a tour, I set aside that time to write. And you know, it could be like a 2 month period where half the record is composed with Oliver and Tommy, or with this one, you know, it probably took more like 4 months, 5 months to write everything, get the demos finished, and then start working on the actual final recordings. So it was probably about an 8 month period, something like that. It's cool, you know, in retrospect, but We've always been the kind of people that look forward and try to evolve, and I think it's one of the ways that we've been able to stay relevant and grow, have a new fan base with each record. It's kind of cool, like I think it's 10 years for the Black Halo, that's kind of a cool thing, but I've never been a real, like, an anniversary kind of guy. I don't know, it's just not. And the fact is that time just has been flying by, you know, which is cool. But, you know, sometimes I have to look at my iPhone from taking photos that I complain about people doing all the time to actually remember some of the things that I've done. You know, whatever you do, whoever you meet, you're gonna somewhere down the line you're gonna meet them again. I think it's important to be respectful with people, even if you don't particularly like them. If you can deal with people in a certain way and be compassionate, I think that's important. That's something I've learned, because you run into these people again, you know. And also, Enjoy what you do, you know. Love what you're doing, and you won't feel like it's a job. Mm-hmm. That's something that once I decided to do Camelot full time, I never looked back, and it's been awesome. They have different connections within the industry. Like, for example, different distributors throughout the world. In Germany, they're part of Universal, which is great. They also are big fans of Camelot and totally were like going big time to sign us, you know. And you want to work with people like that, because they want to prove to you that they're the right label for you. And, you know, they're diversifying. They're a really good growing label, making smart choices when it comes to the bands they're picking. So. normally we release an album and we tour Europe. This time we're touring North America first. But that's going to be cool too, because we're doing some summer festivals, and then by the time we tour North Europe, we'll already have two or three videos out from Haven. So there'll be a lot of cool people that maybe haven't heard the record. There'll be more people into it. Cool visuals that we can hopefully bake into our live show. And most of the European tour dates are confirmed. I think we still need to announce a couple of French shows and maybe some German shows. So we're excited about the whole next round, which will probably be like a 2.5 year process of touring and going to new countries. We'll probably be doing more Asian countries this time.
Okay.
We're doing more cities in Canada. We've never really played Western Canada. We're playing some new places in France, new places in like Switzerland, Austria. So it's cool. No, I mean, it's probably our biggest market, actually, uh-huh. The United States. We're doing a big North American tour, like I was saying. Special guest, Dragon Force. And I don't know, it's kind of cool because we have a pretty stable fan base in most of the regions, you know. But North America, for some reason, has been really kind to us in terms of the concerts coming out and everything. And, I don't know. I mean, knock on wood, it's been pretty cool. Yeah, a few. Like, we have a little bit of industrial influences here and there. Maybe a little bit modern metal / rock influences. We wanted to go for a little bit harder mix, a little bit more in your face, with maybe the guitars a little more up front. But you know, with every record, we want to add new things, new tastes, without going overboard. And I think that's a balance that is can be tricky. And you know, up till now, we've been able to do that, and I think that's part of our signature, is to maintain that sound, but also add new things that we want to hear and that we. We know the fans want. They're always wondering what's going to happen. You know what's, and I remember on one album we had this bandonian part, like this Argentinian accordion. It was actually, I think it was our producer's idea. And when I first heard it, I was like, "This is too much. This is just too out of place," you know. And then. Once it came out and I started getting used to it, and now it's like fans love it, you know. And that's what I have to remind myself every once in a while. It's like, this is what a lot of our fans dig, you know. They like that kind of throwing in that wrench in there somewhere. So that's a cool thing that we have a fan base that has an open mind with that.
You're listening to La Grosse Radio. Je suis le chanteur, le groupe Europe.